Yeah, we come into the topic, the introduction to Ho Chi Minh City, its history, urban planning, and architecture. And I will introduce myself again. I'm Dr. Nguyễn Minh Hiếu. I'm a Director of International Affairs of Faculty Industrial Fire in Tôn Đức Thắng University. And also, I'm a lecturer in Interior Design Department. So in this topic, we will figure out the information about Ho Chi Minh City. First, we go through its history. And along the history timeline, we will figure out how the urban planning changing through the time. And then we will see some introduction about architecture. If we talk about the history of Ho Chi Minh City, I can say that it is a multi-layer history, also multi-layer control. Why? We are not similar like Hanoi and Thang Long. In Hanoi, Thang Long, they have more than 1,000 years of history. But in Ho Chi Minh City, we usually say that we have only 300 years of history. So what happened before that? First, we have to know what is single layer control and what is multi-layer control. If we see about this one, we can see that the first six great civilization of human mankind, we had Maya, Inca, China, India, Egypt, and Mesopotamia. At that time, the clarify and the identity of each great control are very unique and totally different between each other because they were isolated. But at that time, the logistics and transportation at that time not developed high enough to make the control interfere and affected to each other. So during that time, we had this one is a single layer control landscape, very unique. But then, when they expanded the kingdom, of course, there will be the conflict and also the trading and business. For example, we had a campaign of Alexander the Great of Greece or Cyrus the Greek of Mesopotamia, Attila the Hunt or Mongol, and so on, many, many more. We call this the interaction and interchange process, and it creates a multi-layer control landscape. So did the same thing happen in Saigon? Saigon is another name, a more common name of Ho Chi Minh City. I prefer the name Saigon, and I will explain later. So the same thing happened in Saigon. It's a multi-layer control and history of Saigon. So this is the location of Saigon in the world map. You can see the geography and territory. It's facing to the ocean, and also we had a big mountain high rise along the west side of Vietnam. So the river flow on this way and created many river system, very complicated. If we have closer look at this map, we can see that the river system flow through the south and also in Saigon of Vietnam. It's very complicated. It's like a maze. So what happened during that time? Here is Saigon. It's right in the corner, in the intersection with many rivers. The first layer, we can say that this is the first layer from history. This is the Funan. Nowadays, they're still finding some trace of Funan Empire. And if we take a look at the historical map, this is the Funan Empire. So Saigon also include inside the Funan territory. Funan, it used to be the biggest kingdom in Southeast Asia. And now currently we have the trade from Funan we can find. And during your visit to Ho Chi Minh City, I will also bring you to this museum so that you can see the tracing from 1,000 years ago. We had the trade from the Funan people, but they are not sector. They are not settled and build a kingdom right in the Saigon. Based on what the written in the description, ancient stone description, and also by the archaeological finding, we can see how the decorative and the art of that time is very similar to nowadays. We can see the Indo-Saphair control, which based on the Indian style. And also we can see that in Cambodia, in Thai, Myanmar, Burmese, this is on the same way of decorative, but this is more original. And this is also the tracing, but the nearest tracing we can find is in Nam Cát Tiên province, is near Saigon. Because at that time, we then not have enough technology to settle down and begin to build a kingdom or maybe a city or a town inside Saigon. Saigon at that time is just the place for the criminal, the refugee, and the people who try to run away from their homeland to find to try to survive in another land. So the second layer I want to talk about the Moi. In Vietnam we call Người Moi. This is the Moi, and they are the second owner of Saigon through the history timeline. Because this is Saigon, in the origin, this is like a flooded land with many many trees like this one. This is a swamp, so people cannot build a town, cannot build their homeland in here because it's very dangerous and very difficult for agricultural. In Vietnam, we call Rừng Ngập Mặn. Nowadays, nearby Saigon, we are still have this kind of geography and territory. And also there are many dangerous animals. For example, we have a crocodile or tiger. They are everywhere in Saigon at that time, like 1,000 years ago. So it's very difficult to build a kingdom in such an area. But then we have that kind of people. They will try to find the place for living inside the jungle, inside the swamp, and they build their homeland. So in this one, you see this is the steam tribe and their vernacular architecture. Nowadays, we still can find some vernacular home of steam people. Of course, this is the new build, just 100 years ago, but this kind of architecture happened 1,000 years ago from the people. They are the second owner of Saigon land, just after the Funan Empire. This is the steam and the moist. But when we had in the north of Vietnam, we had the Nguyễn dynasty, the middle and the north of Vietnam, they grow up and they give more power. And as you already know about the fighting between the Nguyễn dynasty, the Vietnam, the King tribe, and we fighting against the Champa, we colonize and also we eliminated the Champa people. So when the Nguyễn dynasty, they start to expanding their territory, they go to the south and they occupy the land. This is the process, timeline process of expanding from the Nguyễn dynasty through the south. And in 1867, they unified the whole Vietnam at that time. So this is Ho Chi Minh City. Sorry. Ho Chi Minh City here. This was totally occupied. And of course, they will begin the migration. They bring the Vietnamese people go to the south. And of course, they start to build the headquarters and the control system. And at that time, they called Saigon, belong to a land called Thuận Thành Trấn. Yeah, in Thuận Thành Trấn, this land. To control the land completely, they start to build a citadel. Because this is the mindset of Vietnamese fortification and military landscape. We follow the mindset of the Chinese people to build a citadel and control the land. And the community and people can stay outside. And this is the first citadel of Saigon. This is called Gia Định Citadel in Gia Định province. At that time, there's no name Saigon. They called Gia Định of the Nguyễn dynasty. And this is in the beginning of 19th century. This is the first map ever drawn in Saigon. This is Saigon River. which you already see in the one paper of this terminal. That is Saigon River. And also we can look through the archive and we see the portrait, the painting of the Saigon at that time. The people, they still use the boat for trading and for business, making business, or maybe for military purpose, for defense, the province, the land. And this is still very ruined, very empty land, because this is just a new settlement. Before the Nguyễn dynasty come, as you already see, we only have the Funan. They cannot control Saigon because of the geography, very difficult. And also the Mois are very oscillated in their technology. So they cannot start to build a steady city. But when the Nguyễn dynasty come, everything is different. They start to build a citadel and it keep expanding the community, because when you got protected by the citadel, you can feel safer against the animal or against the robber, against the criminal, and you can start to do the business. And also we have another community in here. What are they? They are the Chinese people. During that time, there was a war between the Ming and the Qing dynasty in China. And as you know, the Ming dynasty are defeated. So the Ming people, they try to run away by the boat, and they refugees in Saigon. But at that time, the central government of Saigon not allow them to stay inside of Saigon territory. Instead, they were sent to remote area on this side. But the Ming dynasty, they have the Chinese mindset. And as you know, in Bangkok, you have Chinatown, right? As you already know that, the Chinese people, they are very good at making business. They can do business very well, and they can roll up the whole community. They protect each other. So time after time, the Ming refugee, they start to grow up, they start to develop and making a lot of business, maybe even better than the Vietnamese people. And they start to settlement this one, and they call Chợ Lớn. Chợ Lớn means, this means big market. Chợ Lớn, big market. So that, this is the community for the Chinese people refugee. And this is for the Saigon Yadin, and they start to control. And the Chamba people were defeated, and they cannot regain Saigon anymore. They just offer Saigon to the Nguyễn King for robots, for marriage, for wedding. So Saigon belongs to Vietnamese. And we have that this time. And you can see this one, we have many strange ways. And this strange way is the artificial water tunnel, water channel. They already have many river here. Because as I already say that Saigon have a complicated river system everywhere, similar to the south of Vietnam. But if you use the boat to make the business, to make the logistics and transportation, it's very difficult to go search to a canal. It's very curved and very difficult to move. So the Nguyễn King ordered people to make this train tunnel to connect all the roving and all the part of the city together to more easy to mobility, more easy to make business for logistics, and also more easy to control the land. So we have this one. All of this one were made by the Vietnamese people. And we have this one. This is the artificial river channel. And as you can see that, all of the river channel will be end up inside the citadel, because this is the headwater, the brand of the whole city. And at that time, we have some French technology imported to Vietnam due to some visiting from Vietnamese officer, and also some visiting from the French. They come to Vietnam and they take photo. So this is the river. Sorry, the artificial channel at that time. As you can see that the business grow up very fast, and this is, they make a good business at that time, because they can transfer fruit, the stuff, the clothes and the artisan handmade stuff from only outside province, only related province outside Saigon. They bring inside Saigon and they do the selling, they make business there. And it starts to make Saigon become the central land of the south of Vietnam. So at the beginning, Saigon is the place with many complicated river and dangerous place. People cannot live. But then that disadvantage become the advantage. They need that river system to make business. So Saigon start to begin the capital of the south of Vietnam. And at that time, the Nguyễn dynasty, they start to build the architectural style. It's very similar to Sino-Saphir style. Sino-Saphir style is the style affected by the China. As you know, Vietnam was once in the past, no, many times in the past were colonized by the Chinese people, and we adaptation and we learn from the architectural. So in the north of Vietnam, Thang Long, and also in the middle, we have the architectural style a little bit similar to a Chinese style. So when they occupy Saigon, they bring that kind of architectural and they build inside Saigon. But when the Nguyễn dynasty are controlling the land, we facing the colonial process of the whole world. As you know that the colonial kingdom, like we had the French, the British Empire, the Spanish, the Portuguese, they start to go to Southeast Asia and they make colonize from our country. So we had the fourth layer. They are on top of the Nguyễn dynasty layer. It's the Indochine. Indochine is a style of architectural work created by the French when they come to Vietnam, Laos, and Cambodia. They start to build their mindset of architectural, which means the fusion between the French style and the local style. This is the map from the Paris. Why I show the Paris? Because Paris map so clearly mindset of the French people. Clearly map of the French people when they do the urban planning. When they do the urban planning, they want to make the boulevard, the straight line, and the everything based on the geography. They never want to make the curve thing or something like that. They want to make everything under control by human make. Human can win the nature. So this is the replan of Saigon. As you see before, when the Nguyễn dynasty, they come, they start to make the artificial tunnel. They want to use the river. But when the French come, they want to make boulevard. Because the Westerner, sometimes they're very afraid of water inside the city because they have the Celtic mindset during the medieval time. They think that the water can bring the disease, can bring the pollutant, and can make the epidemic. Just like the Black Death in the 14th century in Europe. So the French, they don't want the river system anymore inside the city. They just keep the big river, just like the Seine River in Paris, but on the artificial channel inside the city, they bury it. This is Saigon urban plan map by Officer Chakner of French. So from this one is the artificial river channel were made by the Nguyễn dynasty. It's become the boulevard. The French people, they just buried it and make it become the road, the boulevard. And also this one, this is the Grand Channel in the past. And when the French, they occupy Saigon, they make it become the big boulevard. And now this is the most beautiful road in Ho Chi Minh City. When you come, I will also bring you to this road to see that how people they enjoy this. This is a big boulevard, but in the past, this was the river, artificial river, connect from the citadel to outside. So this is the mindset of the French. And also you can see that from this one. And when the French come, the citadel are no longer the big citadel. I will take note some about this one. In the past, we had a backwise citadel, and it's going to be like this one. Very big one. But then there is a revolution and a civil war between the Nguyễn dynasty. They are general, they make a revolution. And the central government from the south, from the middle of Vietnam, they have to bring the royal troops to defeat the revolution army in this citadel. But they struggle a lot to defeat this citadel because it's so steady, so strong to defend. So after they take back the citadel to prevent in the future that someone can occupy and make another revolution, the Nguyễn dynasty just destroyed the whole citadel and they build the smaller one. So that in the future, if someone makes the revolution, they can easily defeat it. That's why we got this kind. This kind of citadel is different than before. So when the French they attack Saigon, they defeated this citadel very easy because it's not steady enough to defend against the artillery of French. Artillery of French are very powerful and very high, the top technology at that time. So this is the plan of Saigon. You can see that no longer river inside the city. Everything was buried. They only keep the big river. This here can be two sides, a little bit bitty because if we can control the river well, this here can be the big value for the city, not only for landscape, but also for many other benefits. But also, it's a good side because it can easy for urban planning and easy to maintain the fresh and the cleanness of the city. So this is what planned by Indochine government. So as you can see that during I talk about the history, I also sharing with you about the urban mindset, urban planning mindset through the time to time of each layer. And we can take another see up another map and on the artificial river channel become the road. They are no longer the river, but outside of the city they still keep it because it's just an empty space, nothing there, so they just keep it. The friend, they just keep it. And this is the drawing map of Saigon at that time. And the city from the coastline, sorry, from the Saigon River. In the past, did you got any problem during internet connection? Sorry, did you hear me well?
Yes.
Thank you. During my sharing, if you got any question, you can interrupt me anytime because this is a discussion and you are welcome to do that. So when the French, they attack Saigon, they use this river and they use a big battleship and they're fighting artillery and they destroy the citadel here. So when the French, they occupy, they build a fortification to defend the river line. And of course, we can see that they start to build the cathedral, a new kind of architecture which never happened before in Vietnamese mindset because Vietnam and also Thailand, we have temple, we have pagoda, but the church only an alien from the Western mindset of architecture.
Excuse me, Hugh. Just a moment. I tried to locate the location of the citadel in the map, in another computer. I just wondering which location of the contemporary map is the location of this citadel.
Yeah, thank you for your question, Achan Api. This citadel, after the friend, when they want to expanding the army through the south of Vietnam, they not enough manpower. They have to mobilize the whole troop to the South Vietnam to occupy more land. So they afraid that if they not maintain enough troops inside the citadel, this citadel will be reoccupied by the Vietnamese. So the choice of the French army, they just destroy the whole citadel. So right. Now there is no trace of any citadel in Ho Chi Minh City.
Oh, okay. And which location that's supposed to be the location of the citadel in the current map?
Yeah, maybe I will open the Google because I'm not putting that map on this slide.
Okay, right. Okay, fine. Yeah. Okay, that's okay. Yes, please go ahead. Yeah. Continue.
Yeah, but thank you for pointing out. I think this is my mistake. I should also include the map nowadays. But nowadays, it is on the very central of Ho Chi Minh City. When you come, and we will have one day walking around. If you accept my schedule, my proposed schedule, so we will have like one morning to walking around this because it's many museum. Museum in this area, so you can see that how in the past the roads could be, because on the road system they still keeping, but the fortification they destroyed.
We can discuss about the schedule and the detail of the trips later after your lecture. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Thank you, Achan Api.
Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah, so you can see on this map, they start to destroy the citadel. Destroy half of the citadel were destroyed, and they start to build the military camp. For the military camp, you can still see it nowadays. And we will see it during your visit in Ho Chi Minh City. But on this map, the only half of the citadel were existed. And also the Chợ Lớn, as I mentioned before, this is still the headquarter, the base of the Chinese refugee community. So Saigon at that time, it become the two core, Saigon and Chợ Lớn. This is Saigon and this is Chợ Lớn. They are connect by this one. This big road to connect between. And this is, they are not united together. Saigon is Saigon and Chợ Lớn is Chợ Lớn. And this is on the 20th century. Yeah, you can see this one. Chợ Lớn area and Saigon area. Nowadays, they are still the two big core of the business and administrator of Ho Chi Minh City. Sorry. And as you know, after the French were kicked out of the Vietnam because they lose again, the Viet Minh, and we have another new enemy, the American. And the American, when they occupy the South Vietnam, we had the fifth layer, and we can call this one the modernist, and also the Greek layout. Greek layout is the mindset of the function architectural of American. We always say that the American, they are very focused on the function of the things. This is the variety of American Greek. When they do the urban planning, they are not like the French who make the boulevard. Boulevard connect to a big landmark and they make the boulevard. And from the boulevard, they will make another side road. The Vietnamese mindset, they want to make the river at the center and they start to do the urban planning. But the American, they make everything like a grid, like this one. This is their mindset. As you already see in Chicago, or New York or something, they put Washington DC, they do something like this. So this is Đô Thành Saigon. Đô Thành Saigon, it means capital Saigon, because at that time, we can say that a civil war between the North and the South of Vietnam, and the capital of the South is Saigon. Đô Thành Saigon means capital Saigon. And you can see the difference, because now the American, they make the grid urban blending of the whole Saigon and Chợ Lớn. And at that time, Saigon and Chợ Lớn are united to the big Saigon. And they make the grid everywhere. And also the center, you can see the tracing of the boulevard still start to fading because they cut the center into the square form, the grid planning. And also, they keep expanding the city because this is the mindset of the grid. The grid keep expanding by own sign. And this one, we have, need the Tongsung Nhat Airport. And also we have like a university here. That's the cutting. And also the architecture at that time, it's very similar to the military base camp because we are at war, everything for war. In Saigon, in 1968, the most tragedy, the most dramatically of the war at the time. So what about the river? The big river at Saigon at that time, they are still the main logistic, I mean the naval logistic from the satellite province to bring the people, to bring the worker, to bring the stuff, to bring the business, many things to Saigon to connect. And when the business grow up and keep expanding due to the mindset of American, the American, they are the democracy. They want to make people spending a lot to grow up the whole economy. So when the business grow up, the people keep coming and they start to stay inside their boat, and we have boat house. They just renovated their boat into the house. And when they stay on their boat and they stay in that river, of course, they will make it polluted. This is the community, the boat house community along the river, around the Saigon Canal, Saigon River. And at that time, Saigon River become polluted very badly. And also on the river system inside the city, it polluted. And we suffering that a lot until now. It smell really bad. But in 2016, we got funded by Germany government and also by Europe, as a scientist. They have them scientific community. They funded and where they bring the new technology to clean up the Saigon River system. Yes, this photo is just taken in 2012, so not so long ago. And also this one in Ho Chi Minh City in 2004. So what happened during the grid layout and modernist? The biggest problem of the grid layout, I think the biggest advantage is easy to control, easy to maintain, easy to defend during the war. But the disadvantage is that it creates something that not good for the sustainable development because it tries to make everything the same, but actually we must have something that sends the core to connect and to balance all the activity of the whole city. Cannot make the grid layout like the American do. And after we got united the whole country, we have the top layer. This is the metropolitan, as you see nowadays. For the metropolitan, they keep changing the mindset and they make Ho Chi Minh City become a multi-core. We have this multi-core outside. The reason why we have to try to do the multi-core outside because we try to expanding the city, because in the center it's very surrounded, very crowded, and we will make it multi-core, the satellite town, so people will move out of the city and stay outside, so that it can less stress of the inner city because nowadays it's traffic jam and polluted and on the underground facility for water desorted, water funding, or landscape have overload. So we try to make the multi-core. And the key point, the key success for multi-core is the transportation system. As you can see, we have many other province outside, and we move the airport outside of the city in Long Thanh, just like Suvan, just like the case of Suvarnabhumi in Bangkok. You have Dong Mueang Airport, but you build Suvarnabhumi so that you can try to move out the people outside of the city to lower the stress up in city Bangkok. So we have this one, and we hope we in the mindset in 2025 we can successful on this model. So people can stay outside of the city, and at the beginning of the day they can come to inner city, and the inner city no resident, only the administration building and business and banking, and outside is for education or resident. But the big problem is that we facing the delay of the transportation, the metro, the PR, the MRT. This is still not exist in Saigon. This is like already 10 years late. So now it's very crowded and very straight up the overload facility inside Saigon. Of course, when you come to Ho Chi Minh City, you will suffer about the traffic jam, but maybe you familiar because in Bangkok, it's the same. So for the metropolitan system, for the inner city, luckily, we still have the district two. The district two is a spare space because we have district one and district five, which means Saigon and Chợ Lớn. Saigon is district one and Chợ Lớn is district five. When we united, we call all of them in Saigon. But district one and district five is the core center of the whole city. But we have district two is nearly empty. But then we start to do the connect by the big brick wall. We building a brick wall to connect between the district one and district four to district two. And then we can use the space bay of the district two to lower the stress up in the city of Saigon. So currently the strategy for urban planning of Ho Chi Minh City nowadays, we do the two strategy. The first strategy is we build the surrounding core outside of the city, and we will connect them with the high-speed transportation. The second solution is that we try to use sustainably and effectively the space bay inside the city, which were left during the French time and American colony time. Now is the time to use them. And you can see this one, the high speed brick road to connect between the two districts, the two sides of the river system of Saigon. And all the community, all the facilities start to grow it up, start to build it up, and make the city become the metropolitan. Of course, this one that I mentioned before, on the river system in the past, they were the natural river system or maybe the artificial river system for transportation, for logistics. Nowadays, they become the value for water heritage inside the city because they can provide landscape, they can provide environment. And even we have the river bus, Saigon water bus, we are start to develop that system. In Bangkok, you already have, and it's very nice in Chao Phraya River and also in a small river inside of Bangkok. I think there are big similarity between Bangkok and Ho Chi Minh City. And you are a very good case study for us to study from you. Now, thanks to the European, thanks to the German funding, they make the Saigon River system a very cleanest. And this is become a jewel of Ho Chi Minh City. Why, when I talk about the urban planning of Saigon, I talk so much about the river system because originally Saigon is the land of river more than land. So now the old image of Saigon are revived in the new form. This one, you can see that one. And the river will come soon. So when I talk about the history and also the urban planning, we have five layer. First is the Funan, with not so much tracing left because the Funan people, they're the owner of this land, but they do nothing. They make it the empty land because they cannot control this land. But then we have the Champa, the Champa people, which are now still have archaeological sites nearby Saigon. And we have the third layer in the Nguyễn Dynasty, when during your visit, you can see that many old pagoda and old house of the Nguyễn Dynasty, and you can see the Vietnamese original vernacular style of Nguyễn Dynasty at that time in the 17th century. And then we have Indochine and modernist. Indochine and modernist are currently the most favorite style in Ho Chi Minh City because they are still very strong in the mindset and in the memory of Saigon people. For the Nguyễn Dynasty style, they are very far away. They're already far away, and sometimes they are oscillated. And of course, we had the sixth one in the metropolitan. You see, now we had the new the innovation of 4.0 technology. So the whole country are changing and adapting new technology. So if we talk about the architectural, we already talked about the history and urban planning. So how about the architectural of Saigon? First, you can see that we have the Viet, or we call the King Tri. The King is the, not King, King style. King tribal is the most population tribe of the whole Vietnam. Just like the Thai tribe in Thai. And this style is very similar to Hanoi and also to Hue style of architecture. We use the dragon. We not use the chamba like you. We use the dragon. And this is in Yat Lam Pagoda. It's more than 200 years ago. Yat Lam Pagoda is like Sino-Surfer style. And you see this one, the decorative, the structure, the way they use the wooden beam. Everything it's very similar to Chinese architectural, but it's a big style because we have something unique from us. For example, big style of roof. This line is straight, not curved. It's straight and it's only curved at the end. But for the Chinese style, it curved all the way. We will see it later. Just one example. So we still have our uniqueness. And also in Yat Lam Pagoda. On the schedule, we are very tight schedule. We come here only 5 days. So maybe I cannot bring you to this pagoda, but let's see if we have time for this, because this is one of the oldest pagoda in Ho Chi Minh City. Yeah, you can see this Vietnamese roof. It goes straight and then it curves at the end. And also the structure. We have the structure inside, similar to the way used up dugong. And we have the Indochine architecture. So talk about Indochine. I think we spend many time to talk about this, because Indochine is now the style that the Saigon people, they love it. When the French come, of course, firstly, they will bring the religion, social religion spreader. So we had the pirates. When they come, they just come by themselves. They spread out the mindset, but cannot educate the way of building the cathedral, just like the French. So they use the local artisan from Vietnam. And as you can see, this one is a cathedral, a church, but the architectural style is very similar to pagoda. It looked like a pagoda because at the time they used the artisan and the builder from the one who used to build pagoda before. So this is vernacular church style. And then when they can bring out more architect and also the builder from France, they can start to build the church in the Western style. So this is the neo-Gothic style. Of course, they will bring the army soldier after the religious soldier in the name of protecting the religion, protecting the God. So when they bring the troop will start to build the citadel. And this one, they build on the floor of the citadel of Saigon. When they didn't draw the citadel, they start to build this one. It's a military camp for the French troops. And this is still exist nowadays. This is Martin des Palais Réfort in Saigon. And when you come to Saigon, you can still see this one. And this is the main entrance to go to the citadel in the old day. But now everything gone, no trace in left. And also military hospital. Sorry, I got some flu. So this one is pre-colonial style. It's very simple, based on function, because for the army, they don't need it to be beautiful. They just need it to be aesthetic, because for defense for themselves, to use for themselves. And after the soldier come, we have the scientists and the administrator. They come to control the colony. They come to exploit the colony to get more benefit to bring to France. So when the scientists, they come and the elite people come, we have new, more beautiful style of architecture. For example, we have this one. It's the governor place of Hanoi. And this is the neoclassic. Neoclassic is they want to revive the classic architecture, but they make it more simple, to easy to adaptation to the mindset of the people. But this one Hanoi, but this one in Saigon, it's less than magazine Chakner. Now it's the moon, but then we lost the rooftop. And also this is Ho Chi Minh City Museum of Art. We will visit it on the trip if you accept my schedule. And this is the Art Deco style. You can see many Art Deco buildings in the whole Saigon. Because at the time, Art Deco is the kind of architectural that can easy for the people to be adaptation, because they think that city is more funny, yet beautiful. And it's not so strictly like the classical. It can be more easily to adapt for business, more friendly architectural. So this one is Art Deco style. Many buildings in Ho Chi Minh City now follow Art Deco style. And of course, when the scientists come, their wife will come to stay with their husband, to make the government a friend. They want the scientists to feel okay in such a faraway country. But their wife will feel homesick. So they need something to similar to French architectural. So we have this one, or this one. And this style is North France local style, because it's very similar to the North France style. In the North of France, the climate very similar to Ho Chi Minh City. It's many heavy rain, and it's hot and high humidity. So in the North France, it's similar, and architectural that can easily bring an adaptation to Vietnam. So on up this one, it start to develop to another style. We have eclectic style. Eclectic style is the fusion between neo-Gothic, the Westerner, and also vernacular, and they make something in the middle for easily people in Vietnam can learn and can accept this. Not an alien, they can, okay, I accept this. And also pre-colonial style, they become the tunnel and train warfare, because in the Second World War, the French building the Maginot to defend from the German Empire. So they use that mindset of military to build many tunnel and train warfare everywhere in Vietnam to defend against the Viet Minh. But for this one, from the academic and scientific people, they make the new thing called the Indochine architecture. The completely new thing. We have like Indochine Scientific Institute. As you can see that we have, this is like Western style, but the roof is Vietnamese style. This is the fusion between the Vietnamese and the French. We will also visit this building. You can see at the row, at the ground floor, this is Western style. You have a structure of column. But on the rooftop, you see that it looks like a pagoda and temple of Vietnam. We can look in closer one. You can see the replica of dugong. But actually, they are not using dugong. They use concrete and brick. So the dugong, now they become a decorative, no longer a structure. Sorry, my computer not feedback anymore. Okay, for this one, you can see this is a dugong. But this is just like, just made from concrete and brick. So no longer they are a structure, just like before, just a decorative. Also in this one, you will see more clearly. Of course, we still use the yin yang group. So this is a very big fusion. So Indochine style, you will see it in Saigon, old building, it's everywhere. Also, we will visit the Minhung. Minhung is the way we call the Chinese refugee. We will go to District 5 and we'll see the Minhung people. Minhung is the, when they defeated from the Qing dynasty, they run away from China and they come to Saigon to avoid the death sentence, from the Qing Empire. They come to Vietnam. This is the Ming dynasty people. They have the another way of control, another way of doing their worship and everything, and also the custom, the hairstyle, but they were defeated and they come to Vietnam. So we've had the big community of the Ming dynasty in District 5, and their architecture are very unique. It's the Chinese style. As you can see, the room of Chinese, as I mentioned before, it's curved from the beginning to the end. For the Vietnamese roof style, it will go straight first, and it curves at the end. But for the Ming, our Chinese architecture side, it will go like this one. It's curved right at the beginning. But this is Vietnamese. This one is Vietnamese, like this. So we will have many Minhung architecture, which means Sino-Sefe or Chinese architecture style. For this one also. As the pagoda or temple for this one. And it's in a District 5 in everywhere. So we have another style, it's modernist. Modernist, we follow the mindset of functional system of the American. This is the modernist in Hanoi, and it's different than the modernist in Ho Chi Minh City, because at that time, Hanoi followed the Soviet Union mindset of building the condominium house. Everybody stay together because we are equal. We are the same. Nobody can live better than other, something like that. We all the same, we all similar. That is just the mindset of the Soviet Union. So there be a lot of block house like this one, very big one, and for the people to stay inside the house and have a just completely, I mean that just exactly what you need. You have this, you need somewhere to sleep, you need somewhere to eat, and you will need a toilet. So the toilet will share for about 10 or 20 house use the same toilet. I think this one is a nightmare, even now, for many people stay in Hanoi. Can you imagine that 10 family have used one toilet? That's pretty terrible, unacceptable. But in Ho Chi Minh City, the mindset of modernist is better. Modernists in Ho Chi Minh City, they think that Vietnam is a tropical country. So they follow the way of doing the design and decorative to make the sustainable development and less use of the energy consumption of the building. And you have Vietnamese modernist architecture. For example, we have Saigon National Library. They use this one. They use many alarm and they use many fencing and outer cell to isolate the core of the building. So, and also the big roof to protect the building from the direction and make the climate, the microclimate inside building very cool, very comfortable inside. So you less using the electric consumption. So this is also the new mindset of Saigon National Library. Modernist and innovative trend. We will visit this place, of course. This is the must visit place. This is the Independent Palace of Saigon. Before that, it was the Notre Dame Palace. Notre Dame Palace is a place for the governor of France to stay during their colonial in Vietnam. And now it becomes the independent palace. And you can see the facade of this one, they make the imagery of the bamboo. They replica the imagery of the bamboo, the very typical tree in Vietnam. And they make it become the facade to block the direction. Just keep the exact limit of the sun go inside the building and make the building become more sustainable and more comfortable inside. When you come, you can see that the microclimate inside, very okay, very nice. And also we make this one very traditional. So the way that doing the modernist in the south and the modernist in the north is different because they are follow the two mindsets. The first mindset is from the Soviet Union. They try to make the whole social, the whole country under control by the one typical modern. So they just duplicate the first design to everywhere. And the modernist style in the south, they do the innovative trend. They try to make, they try to use the imagery of something very typical from Vietnam, and they use adaptation and they apply it into the design of the building. And also, of course, we had the metropolitan. Now during the internet and data develop, we can strongly connect together. And of course, on the designer, when they study, they not only study about Vietnamese, but they also the study from design of the Westerner, of the another country style. So it will be mixed up. For example, we have many new design projects, many new community for design like this one, everywhere up Saigon. They try to make it become like a Western town or Western street road, something like that. And when we see that, we don't know where we are. We are in Vietnam or we are in Europe, maybe. We don't know. But it's everywhere. This is the real photo taken by me on this one. And also we'll put on the website. This one, you can see this. It looks something like a Western style, but it's just a copy, a replica everywhere. But also we have some good designer. They want to continue the mindset of the Indochine and the modernist. They put the traditional style of yin yang roof and the adaptation in the new style of the contemporary style to the design of the house or even inside the building. They want to make use of the Vietnamese traditional architectural style inside the interior and exterior of the landscape and everything. For example, this one, they try to make the way up the like sofa table, but actually not sofa, the way where we are reading and talking with the guests. They try to use something from the past and they make it in the contemporary style. Or even this one, we can see this is also a good example of the continue of the modernist style. They use the design from the Chamba decorative and Chamba art, and the adaptation into the design of this restaurant. Or even this one, this is the a coffee shop, and they make use of the traditional decorative and typology, and the adaptation to design the interior design of the bar. So this is the metropolitan style now. That is a completely mixed up. And we are struggle up provide the law to control the whole city. So when you landing down, maybe you Thai Airway or North Air or something, but when you land down to Tân Sơn Nhất Airport, and you can take a look at the panorama view of the whole Ho Chi Minh City from the top of the sky, right? And you can see that it's a little bit complicated, a little bit messed up because of the higher, the style, the color, and everything. It's not unified. So it's currently the big problem that Ho Chi Minh City is now facing. That during the metropolitan time. And also we are trying to revive the heritage style. At Achan Api already raised a big question that where is the trade of the citadel? Okay, no trade. So it makes the young generation of Vietnam now, they forget everything. They don't know that Saigon in the past, we had a citadel, the biggest citadel of Vietnam, actually. So my research is also the project of Tôn Đức Thắng University currently doing. Hopefully that in the future, you will also be involved in this one. We will try to make the virtual reality model of the Saigon citadel.